Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kaushik Ramakrishna Sai. I work in a company called Skiller Stripe Software. The brief introduction, as far as JSP is concerned, has been that I've been writing JavaScript for the last 2 years. My code initially used to be like extremely sucky. Actually, 4 years. Code used to be initially sucky. Now it's like much less sucky. Okay, so the talk today that I'm gonna give is about a real-time web and how to actually go about implementing real-time strategies. I mean, implementing real-time infrastructure in your existing web application. So the history on how I actually ended up doing real-time web is we developed this project management software. We got a lot of requests from people saying that, you know, there are like lots of people logged in to the board at the same time, and they want to see what each of them are like updating. So if one is updating something on the board and the other person wants to see what actually is happening. So because of this, we're like thinking about like various ways of like implementing this, probably like reloading the page every couple of seconds, and all of them seemed intrusive. And we had to go, dive into technology and start doing the really cutting edge cool stuff. So that's how we started burning our fingers with real-time web, and as time went by, we kind of like managed to, I think we kind of managed to nail it. So what I'm gonna do today is, I'm not gonna talk through all the options possible. I'm gonna do it another way. We're gonna assume that we are having a web application. So I just created a simple to-do list and a simple to-do list, and we're gonna see how we can actually implement real-time strategy. How we can implement real-time on that web app. So these are the general steps that we would. I would suggest anyone who's like considering real-time to do. First and foremost, before you actually start doing real-time, make sure your code is actually clean, because real-time involves a lot of event-driven programming, and if your code is already messy, then it's going to be really hard to implement real-time. The first step would be to like start using new functionalities available in like modern browsers, like WebSockets, like an awesome technology. I'm pretty sure lots of people would have talked about it through the course of the day. So we're gonna see how we use WebSocket. Start implementing real-time, at least for the new browsers, whereas for older browsers, you know, just don't do anything, just leave it. And then we go to the next step, wherein we say, okay, forget new browsers, old browsers, let's implement real-time for all the browsers. So all the browsers, that includes IE6, which is like probably written for our forefathers. After that, I mean, you have real-time, you have a nice system working, and then you start realizing that maintaining the code is really complicated. So what are the strategies you do? What's ideal? What are things that you can do with the technologies available to make maintenance really simple? And finally, the usual deployment, scalability, and all those big words which give you hair loss. So let me jump into the code. I think that makes a lot more sense. Okay, so this is the code for a very simple web app. So what does it do? It's basically a task. I'd rather like show you this. Alright, simple to-do list, okay? You go click on something, it turns green, which means you completed it. Click it again, turns red, right? Very simple, and yeah, if you want to add a task, you add something else. Now, new task 3. In which case, it would have gotten added twice. Okay, I clicked it twice. I hit enter and this. Anyway, so, to-do list. Mess around, all's fun, right? I'll tell you when it's not fun. when there are like two or three people working on out of the student list, and you have one guy using Firefox, whereas another guy on Google Chrome doing the same thing. So he's like changed it to green, whereas that doesn't get reflected here, right? So what this guy has to do is like constantly keep refreshing the page, which is a sad thing to do. Okay, so let's look at the code. I mean, this is probably how most of us write our code. Initially, if you're at least prototyping, I started writing it like yesterday night, and initially, you know how it is. It's like crazy. So you have like a render task, the render task. So you get tasks from the backend, and you allow tasks to be edited. So get task does a JAX query, gets a list of tasks as JSON object. I mean, JavaScript objects through JSON format. And for every task that was returned, render task. So render task renders it and also like does the callback to like do an edit. So it's a bit of a mess, right? So yeah, what's happening is code is like totally messy. And that technically means the truck factor is one. How many of you know what a truck factor is over here? Any guesses? It's like this. Assume truck factor is technically the number of people who are working on a project on whose absence the project will come to a standstill. So very crudely put, the number of people from your team who have to get run over by a truck for the project to come to a complete standstill. So the truck factor is one, which technically means the guy who wrote that code is the only one who actually understood it. So that's gonna be like really complicated, right? So yeah, why was the truck factor one? Because business logic, data, and rendering are all tied up. There are like two functions, which does the rendering, which also does the data fetch, which handles the data, and which also does like the logic on the click, right? Now, such codes are really, really hard to test. Testing is extremely hard, and feature addition is even more harder, because you're like, you already have a really big, big messed up system, and you're trying to squeeze in something else within the pores, and that's like adding complication, chaos to the system, right? Which all boils down to the fact that there are going to be bugs. No excuses, there will definitely be bugs. I'd be really surprised if a guy can write a code like that and come and say it's completely bug-free, right? So what are we gonna do? First step, step zero, is to clean our code. Be ready for real time. Step zero is essentially decouple logic, data, and rendering. So let's look at the code again. So I am gonna show you a slightly different version of the code. Cool. So what I'm gonna do, what I've done over here is I've used Backbone, which is like a nice JavaScript framework for writing like rapid web applications. There was actually supposed to be a talk on Backbone. Unfortunately, it was not possible. So, so Backbone, what it does, it kind of implements the MVC strategy on the front end. So you have like models, and you have collections, which are like a list of models. So what am I gonna do? Every time you get data, you like get the data and like populate the collection, create a model for each task and like populate it. And you can also, it also does signal handling. So technically, if it fires a signal, every time a new model is created, every time a new model is edited, or anything of that sort, a signal is created, and you can listen to the signal and like do implementation. So essentially, what am I doing? I'm breaking down and like isolating my models, isolating the logic, and how whenever there's a task change, the so isolating rendering. So whenever a task changes, I mean, when you like change it to like done or not started, how that gets rendered, and you have your logic separately. So the click logic on the DOM structure is separate. So this is not technically completely orthogonal MVC MVC example, but this is a way, this is a place to get started. So from that convoluted code, you've come to a slightly more organized piece of code. So yeah, you have so what's happened
is
code is much more cleaner, which technically means code is also easily testable. Change in logic, data schema, and rendering is easy. So if you're like changing the way your task model is like passed, or the way tasks are rendered on the page, or how you handle it. So instead of like clicking it, you want to put a checkbox. So all those things have been like decoupled. So you can you only have to change small bits of code instead of like all the code. And yeah, it technically avoids repetition and all the good traits of good programming. Adding new functionality is easy. So this is where you have to be in order to even start doing start thinking about real time. So step one, what are we gonna do? WebSockets. Bring in real-time support for browsers which support the awesome HTML5 WebSocket spec. Write a fail-safe for browsers written for our forefathers. I mean, that's technically an Internet Explorer. So make sure that browsers which have WebSocket, you use the WebSocket. And for browsers which do not have WebSocket implementations, don't do anything. Just leave it as such. So you can actually tell your customers saying, hey, you know what? We want additional functionalities. Start using it in Chrome or Firefox. It's a bad thing to say, but at least it's a start, right? So a small bit of note on the technologies I've used, technologies you can use, and stuff like that. I'm using Tornado, which is like a Python web server, running on a different port, which basically handles WebSocket connections. So WebSockets are not handled the way HTTP is, right? So what happens, if you get into the details, it's basically you start with a HTTP 1.1 call, and then that gets upgraded into the WebSocket spec. But as implementers, we need not worry much about it, because your framework, your browser, and your server will like take care of it. What you need to know, what you need to like do, is get a server which does the WebSocket spec properly. So Tornado does it. It has a WebSocket handler. So I'm using that. And I'm running it in a separate port, not on my default port 80, but on a different port 8080. I'm going to use the native WebSocket JS API, which comes with a browser, to create a new connection with my WebSocket server and like pass data. Do nothing when on IE, if possible, intimidate the user. This is a nice way to do it. This from a conference for which I was like writing a CO call for proposal. So yeah. Let's look at the code again. So what's now happened is you need to like notice a couple of things here. I've written a method called enable realtime. So I'll come to this check later on. So essentially what it does is it creates a WebSocket connection, connects it to port 8080, and whenever the connection, the server sends a message, this receives it, and this function is the callback for the server's message. So it basically picks a task object and like updates its own connection. So what am I doing in this step? Whenever I do an edit, and it goes to the server, to my actual app server, after I get a success callback, I send a message to all the to the WebSocket server saying, notify all other clients that this update has taken place. So technically, so this is the add task. So I add a task, on the success of it, I send WS to the WebSocket, the variable in which we store the WebSocket handle, the object. So I say WS dot send a JSONified representation of the task. So the task has a name, an ID, and a status, right? this t dot get of name, t dot get of id are all like backbone model methods, which will like basically get the value for the parameter for the property of the task model. So yeah, so what have we done? We send a message and other we send a message from one browser and other servers. Sorry, other servers receive it over here. I mean, browsers will receive the same signal over here. So that's like the second step. So I'll actually show you how it runs. So what I'm gonna do right now, you see both the browsers, I'm gonna click this. So that gets changed on the other thing. So what's actually happening? Goes to the server says, stores it in the backend, then comes back on the success. On the success, sends a message to the live server saying, hey, update all the other clients over here. Now if I open Internet Explorer, nothing's gonna happen. So the changes will happen in Chrome and in Firefox, but on Internet Explorer, nothing is going to happen because Internet Explorer, the version, at least the version I have, does not support the WebSockets protocol. Right. So we got WebSocket running.
So we can I ask?
Yeah.
So the usual thing that we do is add tasks, isn't it? So
yeah.
The incremental data that you will get will be appended to the body.
Yeah.
But usually when you try to do real-time web, it's not simple homogeneous addition.
Yeah, I get it. So I'll actually come to that in the third step. So I just want to like go on incrementally, right? So your add or edit using WebSockets is done. So we have a real-time backend server running on a different port, a full real-time support for new browsers, and no real-time support for old browsers. Okay, a bit of a note here. In the code, I was doing something like this. Now what was I actually doing? Now the WebSocket spec has only been very recently finalized. Until then, all the browsers loved the spec, and the spec was in progress as well. So they used to implement various versions of the spec. So Firefox has this crazy idea of like adding a prefix to anything that has not been like standardized. So in Firefox, you can't just do new WebSocket; you have to do new merge WebSocket. All right. I think in the latest version of Firefox, it's kind of been it's become WebSocket again. And in Chrome, well, it's WebSocket. So what am I doing? I'm actually doing a feature sniff. I'm seeing if the WebSocket feature is available, and if it's on the merge WebSocket name, then I say that's the class I have to use. If it's not there, then I say okay, at least look at WebSocket. So that I say hey, it's a WebKit based browser. If it's not there as well, then I say return. Don't do anything. If it's there, then create the WebSocket connection and do the WebSocket handling. Right? Yeah. So, full real-time support for new browsers, no real-time support for old browsers. If you hate Internet Explorer users, you can stop right here. You have a fully working system. But as it turns out, most of us, I think there was a graph which was shown in the other room, there are like some 26% of internet users who still use IE6, leave alone IE7 or 8. So for those blokes, you really want to like stay, give real time to all your customers, right? You don't want to like selectively, you know, give it off to people. So what are we gonna do in this step? Step two: use a combination of Comet, WebSockets, Flash, and any other possible technology that is possible to create a cross-browser functionality, which is kind of uniform across all browsers. So, Comet, what is Comet? Doing non-HTTP things through HTTP ways. It's an ugly hack, but it works. And people have been using it much before the WebSocket spec even came into play. So, yeah, the technology we're going to use is something like socket.io or js.io or something similar in the front end. And a server which also understands the handshake. So let me explain this to you. I have a browser and I have a socket.io client. Okay, it's a piece of code. What it's gonna do is it's gonna like sniff and say, have I got WebSocket? No. Have I got Flash support? No. Then I should probably do HTTP long polling. So it falls back to the technology available, right? And in the back end, and then once it falls back to the technology available, it notifies its server saying, I'm going to communicate with you for real-time communications using this service, I mean, using HTTP long polling, or using like HTTP multipart calls, or using WebSockets. So what it does is, you saw the previous code where I actually put that feature sniff on like Moz WebSocket, or that was just for WebSocket, like two browsers. We are now talking about like lots of technologies, and the big there's a huge logic involved on deciding which is the protocol that I have to use to communicate with my real-time server. Now libraries like Socket.io makes that easy for you. So it takes care of doing the handshake. It decides on which channel or transport the data can be communicated, and finally, once all these things have been like decided, you can like just create a class and like start sending data, which can be like transferred between the live server and your client. So let's go look at code again. Now, if you see, I use the socket.io.js client library, which gives me this io.connect object. I use that to connect to my server. My server is not a mere WebSocket server any longer. It's now a smart server. It can like decide on which connection it has to use. So once I do the new io.connect, there's gonna be a handshake, and the most ideal transport is going to be chosen. You can you have options to like tell these are the only transports I want the socket io to use, and there are various configurable options which you can use. But let's leave that for a moment. This is like very similar to what we're doing. Whenever it gets a message, connection receives a message, execute this callback. And the callback is exactly similar to what we did on the previous, what we saw in the WebSocket message code.
So this is it's a fallback, isn't it? So if WebSocket is available, it will regularly use
the... Yeah, so WebSocket is the first preferred transport method.
In using this library?
Yeah, this library will like use WebSocket, then calls back to Flash, then falls back to HTTP long polling, then falls back to like God knows a lot of things. I mean iframes, never loading iframes, and form multiparts, and every possible hack in the earth. Okay, so let's actually look at this code again. So I'm gonna kill the WebSocket server. Okay. Okay. We got it on Firefox. We got it on. Now comes the big guy. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to my good friend Localhost on Internet Explorer. Cool. So I think you can like see all the three right now. So the magic happens. Works on IE as well. So cool. We now have all of real-time, system in place which supports every browser. I mean, you can like run it on compatibility mode and start like running Internet Explorer 6 as well. So, you know, suffice like 99% of your consumers. Cool. So are we? Yeah.
You showed library which allows you to do that on the client side.
Yeah.
How does the server side work?
Okay, so what I used is Tornadio, which is basically socket IO's server-side port into Python. So a quick note here, you can use a lot of servers. You've got Event Machine, which can handle WebSocket and like this thing. Tornado has Tornadio, which will like do that. And I think almost every major language has an implementation which kind of uses the socket IO standard in the backend to run a server. So I purposefully did not use socket IO server, but used a Python server, just to say that, you know, the communication handshake has been kind of standardized thanks to socket IO, which has been the first one which actually implemented the thing. I mean, there was JSIO and Naval, which also talked about the handshakes, but socket IO has kind of become the de facto, and socket IO on the client side using dot code and using a server which understands the socket IO handshake protocols on the backend.
Sorry for saying by server side code. So are you saying that my server side code, which will respond back to the JSON, will be same irrespective of a WebSocket connection? Or a connection?
Yeah, between yeah, code. Yeah, that's right. I can actually show you the code, but it's gonna be Python. If you can understand it, like just a second. This is like a socket IO connection, which is a channel connection is from what Tornadio gives. Yeah. Oh, sorry. So you have this thing called channel connection, which has basically the on message, on open, this thing. So the handshake is completely taken care by Tornadio on the back end and socket IO on the front end. So you have to write your logic over here, and that gets like decimated across all channels.
So I'm a little surprised. I don't know whether you can dwell into that much amount of detail, but so usually in a shared nothing architecture, or in any stateless architecture for that matter, the server goes down, it can automatically route to another server. So what happens in a WebSocket which has some kind of a connection built into a server?
Okay, so that's the tricky part, and that's the part where everyone like has a big time nightmare. So there are lots of which I will be talking about right now. So what we had is in this step we bring support for real time even on IE6. Abstracted out API to perform real-time action. So socket IO gives you this nice API by which you say send message, it'll like decide on the transport itself on its underlying layer, sends, receives, all's good, right? Now is when you actually start talking strategies on how to do it. So these are questions that will like invariably pop up. Okay, whenever you look at the examples given by all these Tornadio or like Socket.io, you have like simple chat applications or simple to-do applications like work. But in your real app, you're gonna have things like, I mean, you're gonna have multiple users, and you don't want to see one user's data to go across all the users, right? How about if an action is performed on an API? So you expose APIs to your backend. So I do a post onto the API, and how is that going to be reflected across all the people logged into my client? And how about if we need authentication? I mean, we just, all we did was like, you know what, open connection, send data. Authentication is another big problem. So what the web is heading towards is, especially in the real-time world, is a pub-sub channel-based system. So what there are these systems available, which are like, it's like chat. So whenever you open a new connection, you say, I want to subscribe to this channel. Give me data to this channel alone. Okay? And your backend will like, if you're subscribed to that channel, you can do an authenticate saying, hey, I am this user, please check with my backend. If I am this user, then add me to this channel. And once you add it, it'll like send you data only pertaining to that channel. So you don't get to see what someone else's to-do list is. Right? Step one. Actions, activities performed through the API. Before that, I was telling you about these systems. There was something called Hookbox, which was like written last year, which was amazing in the ability that it performed. I mean, because Hookbox was written on top of a Socket.io kind of system. So all you had to do is open a Hookbox connection, say subscribe to this channel, these are my authentication details. Hookbox will then go check with the backend, see if you are the user with the authenticated details, then subscribe to you to the channel. Juggernaut is another Rails implementation which has been implemented on top of Socket.io, which does the exact same thing. Yeah, I wrote one myself, which so that technically means that it's not like really hard to implement such a thing. So I took up Tornadio and like wrote something over the weekend, which is basically a simple pop-up channel system, which will probably go open source next couple of days. The second thing, what happens when you are doing API calls, right? So you have to like now decide on what your strategy has to be for real time, right? So what was initially happening? So what was initially happening was, David, can you hear me? Okay. What was initially happening was, this is the client which made the action. Sent the detail to the server. Server sends a response. It sends a positive response. This then sends data to the live server, which is like a separate entity in itself, which then tells all the other clients subscribe to the live server, right? Now what happens if an API call interaction happens over here, which means this action will not take place, which means none of these clients will be updated. So the next logical way of like doing it is something similar to this, wherein action is like one direction, goes to server. Now server is the one which actually sends the data to the live server, the back side of the live server, which then decimates the data across all its clients. So the advantage of this is whenever there's an API action happening, this action will like still continue, which means your clients will be updated. Now deciding on which architecture works best for you is one more critical thing. There's one more schematic that you can consider, wherein all these are like bidirectional, and the live server is the one which communicates to the server. So the live server acts like a kind of proxy, which then channels all the transmission to the server. Especially if you're writing chat applications, right? That's like awesome because data gets transferred and then it gets logged on your logging system, right? So this is the second. And what is the final thing? How about having to need to authenticate? Okay, this talk was like meant to be a real-time talk, so I reduced the amount of content I was planning to on like socket.io. So Socket IO has like this method by which you can like send events which are like not which are specific messages pertaining to a particular topic. So you can actually write an event which does authentication handling. So as soon as I open a connection, I send an event saying authenticate me against my backend server. So when that is done, then they add me to the channel.
Yeah.
Two questions there.
Okay.
We have 10 minutes.
If
you ask
one
question.
Okay. Yeah, this is the last slide. So the first question is: you're assuming that all of these things are user events.
Yeah.
So if there is a system event, let's say a timer, or let's say you know a conf job. Which says you know your workflow to come.
Yeah, I get it.
So. In that, you would have a user event triggered directly from the server and
that
schema will work.
Yeah.
Okay. So the second, sorry, I
forgot the second question. All right. Deploy, scale, and much, much more. Okay, these are the really, really, really big problems that you will be facing. Because until now, everything would be like cakewalk. You have a really nice working system on your sandbox. But the second you're talking about deploys, you have to think enterprise, think what your customers will be facing. Running a live server on a different port is not a great idea at all. Reason, there are lots of companies out there which have blocked every other port but for port 80 and for 1. So if I'm running my live server on 8080, my live server actions will not take place at all. If you have an architecture which was like that, the previous one, then your entire system breaks, right? So you need to figure out a way to like write a fail-safe.
So if you're saying you shouldn't run it on a different port, that means you'll need a web server that's WebSocket compatible.
Yeah. So I'm getting to it. So what has to happen is, I mean, I can run it on a different port if my customers do not feel the pinch. But if my customers feel the pinch, then I need to figure out a way to like put a proxy or use a server which can like understand WebSocket connections. And things like that.
So are there any web servers out there that can understand a WebSocket connection?
Nginx has this, Nginx cannot. Technically what happens is, I'm going to use Nginx as like a proxy server, which is everyone who's using Socket IO loves Nginx. But it also has the problem of how it connects, it talks to its client-facing side on HTTP 1.1, whereas talks to its backend, to the server that actually does the WebSocket but that does real time on HTTP 1.0, which technically means you can't use the HTTP proxy model.
But the WebSocket protocol itself violates HTTP 1.1. It's not compatible with the 1.1. Nginx doesn't support WebSockets. So
yeah.
So what are the other options available?
So
if any of us wants to build an application, what web servers do we
have? So okay, I'm coming to it right now. What we'll do is scale. I found as a good strategy. This is like personal, and this is what I have been doing. I use HA proxy, and what I do is, before that, if you're doing HTTPS connections as well, I have a HTTPS terminal point. Like something like start or what's that other thing called?
Like a physical load balancer.
Yeah, which
basically load balancer to do this.
Yeah, basically have an endpoint for HTTPS connections which is like de-encrypted and put it to another port. So what happens, if I get a call on 443, which is like HTTPS, I forward it to 8443. Or if I get a call to 80, just transfer it. HAR proxy is a proxy server, a load balancer, which listens on 8443 and 80. 8443 and 80, and I basically say, if I can like do like URL filtering, saying if I'm getting a call on the Socket IO URLs, then pass it to the Socket IO server or pass it to my main web app server. So the HA proxy is like basically a load balancer which will say, hey, is this connection a web socket, or is this connection a real-time server connection, or is it like this thing based on the URLs? So I have a unique URL for my web socket calls. So for my real-time call. So I'll say anything that goes to that will like go to here or go over to the real-time server, else come over to my web app server. And I think even Nginx,
there is an unofficial patch for it.
Yeah. the TCP
patch. Again, it violates HTTP 1.0, yeah. it's never going to get accepted officially.
So the authentication will happen two different times if you don't use this proxy. So like you have a server and then you have another.
So these are all the backends. Backend.
So can you repeat the question? Can you repeat the question?
The question is, you said there's a backend server which runs something. And then you have a live server, which is obviously something. So I will do the authentication first with the backend server, which is my main server. So when I go to the live server, would I have to authenticate again?
Yeah, since it's the same port and you are using the same listing, right? Using the same your domains, there's no cross domain calls that's happening. So if you're talking about sessions, sessions, right? It's a very tricky thing because some of the transport connections have the habit of like sending your session cookies there. Some of them do not. So authentication, it's actually subjective based on what you're actually doing.
Because you showed the example where it loaded on localhost.
Yeah.
But then the WebSocket connection opened on 8080, which means it has to be authenticated again, isn't it?
There was no authentication I wrote
in
over
this
here.
Case, yeah. But
Over there, what I would ideally do is put a channel-based system over there and say, authenticate me against my backend. So the live server like authenticate me against the backend and then like say, okay, am I accepted or not? So there's a callback happening over there. Yeah. Any other questions?
Any other questions?
Basic question. If second was there for quite some time, it is there for quite some time. Due to some security issues, it was disabled in Mozilla 4 and 5. Recently, it got enabled by the latest version.
Yeah.
Can you talk more about it?
Okay, so
I'll probably add on to that. So, WebSockets was an immature spec for a while, and it finally got production ready. The spec got production ready only 2 months ago, and there were multiple drops of the proposal. Can you talk more about
it? Yeah, so there have been quite a bit of drafts and all having like weird names. But what happened was there was finally an RFC which got accepted like 2 months ago. But until then, every browser, the new browsers loved the idea of WebSocket and jumped into it. So whichever spec seemed advanced enough at that point was implemented. So Chrome was on a different spec, and these specs are basically not the APIs, but internally how the action happens, right? I mean, how the TCP connection takes place or how the HTTP connection takes place.
So a quick question to add on to that. Most of these specs are not intercompatible. Yeah. So if you're writing an application that works on certain spec, it doesn't work on the other one. So how do you ensure that your code continues to work everywhere? I mean, this is a big deal. When node knockout happened, everybody was using Socket.io. Chrome released a new version with the newest draft, and Socket.io broke. All the WebSocket applications broke. So how do you ensure that these things don't happen?
Can't really ensure because you're in a very nascent stage and you don't know what new draft.
My question is, what can you do about it?
What can you do about it? Try to use the standard APIs provided, exposed by your native client, which will not change unless the draft changes. So the on message and on connect and things have not changed for WebSocket. Though internally how it works has changed. So the way your server, your backend server, if you're writing backend servers, you need to be worried because that's where the connection handshakes and things have to be like taken care of, right? So
let's say when the draft updates, the way the handshake happens changes. But you're also writing code for the server side and your code is still not ready for that kind of handshake. So is there a way you can say this is not compatible and you can probably send a HTTP normal response saying, please switch to a fallback.
You could probably like implement a fallback on seeing if there's a connection terminal. And I'm pretty sure most of the browsers will also like raise a deprecation warning. Chrome does for them.
Any other questions? Yes.
Right. Okay. Thank you.